Sorry, we are new.
Come, hello, Miss.
Heavenly Father, we thank you today. Bless you for this wonderful day, Lord, that you have brought us together to celebrate our brother. Bless you, O Lord, that we can say at last our brother has gone home. Bless you and we thank you for the presence of your Spirit. And we pray, O God, that your Spirit will lead and direct every program today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you very much, Pastor. Again, just a quick numbers for us to be able to make sure that today goes as quickly and as smoothly and as eventful as possible. I'm advised this is a non-smoking venue. So for those of you who enjoy a bath or two, please do it at your pleasure outside. The bathrooms are to the my left. I'm going to request that the choir be sitting so that, you know, as these things happen, Yakula, you have to see better than that. Yakula. No one in a bus of two exam. But the number 518 bus of two.
Will go down in the history of annals. That is sanctity. Another sanctity is that Gavin loved the Lord, and the Lord loved him. Blessing him with many talents. Blessing him with a quick mind. Blessing him with leadership skills. Blessing him a handsome appearance, and blessing him with sport talent. I therefore trust the program director that in these 7 days of mourning, Gavin family will take solace from all he represented and from his many achievements. We salute the remaining Watson brothers for their role in the struggle and for remaining so close over the years. The bond between brothers is precious. These children and grandchildren, parents live through you. You and your nephews and nieces come from a remarkable stock. The Watson blood flows through your veins. And it's up to you to keep the legacy alive and make South Africa a better place for all its children. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Lindsay has a letter that she will read for this congregation. This letter was written to Gavin by his mother in the year 2002. The dad passed away in 2010, and Gavin had this letter very close to his heart. Ladies and gentlemen, we want our guests, let's welcome Gavin's daughter, Lindsay.
Vibrating with confidence.
It was always a running joke between us that if I could bottle his positivity and zest for life, we could build the next Red Bull beverage company. That's maybe for another one. Dad was first and foremost a man of God. He loved the Lord deeply and every ounce of his being. His faith was unshakable, unbreakable, and uncompromisable. Growing up with Dad, I would have the privilege of quoting multiple scriptures. One of the earliest I can remember was of him trying to teach me faith as a young child. All I needed was to have the faith the size of a mustard seed and the altitude of mountains. As I got older, I soon learned that the book of Matthew frames faith so perfectly and truly understood why Dad loved verses 17 to 20. He would always preach, walk by faith, not by sight. Dad spent his life praying and seeking the Lord. He would bring spiritual nuggets with whomever he could. Even if it was just a simple phone call, the boys needed to end in prayer. Dad encouraged all board meetings to open and close in prayer. He also encouraged his leadership to get together every morning to start the day in prayer. He very proudly referred to his prayer meetings in the mornings as his prayer mornings. One of Dad's favorite events every year would be the 21-day annual fast, which we would start at the beginning of every new year. He was truly inspired by his friends and colleagues with whom he prayed and fasted. Dad would always say, it takes 21 days to make it or break it. Let's put on the armor of God and make the year spiritual. Growing up as Gavin's firstborn has been a true privilege, not only for me, but for all the siblings and cousins in the family. My oldest cousin, Melanie Sporsonati, had an incredible special bond with Dad. Dad and Corsi, Corsi's godfather, was Corsi's godfather, and my mother Leanne was Corsi's godmother. In the years that followed, and as our Watson clan grew, he would soon become known as godfather to all the children. Not uncle, not mum, not Bukeli or Tata, but as godfather. My mother was in the same context known as godmother. It was always a running joke that one day people may just think that he was like Don Corleone. Dad, not having a clue who Don Corleone was, would always respond, "Well, if he's a man of God, then that's good enough for me." Another fond memory I have of my dad was watching him buy shoes. As he and his brothers previously had a men's clothing store, a few men's clothing stores, he really fancied himself as an expert in men's wear, specifically shoes. Dad would really love every little bit of detail in a perfectly made shoe. Watching him closely was like watching a child about to make toy from a toy store. He would gently press the leather between his fingers, count the number of eyelets, debate the length of the shank and the thickness of the sole. He would then turn the shoe upside down and inside out and press the toe to make sure that just the right resistance. He would then explain in great detail why this was the perfect shoe and that you both had to buy it. Not often the son has an opportunity to reflect and prepare two images from our father. As tough as it has been, it's also been incredibly uplifting. I have so many heartfelt stories of Dad from people all over the world. A close family friend called Dad inspired him to win the athletics event when he was a young man by believing in himself and pushing himself to the breaking point. He said all he could remember was Dad telling him that he needed to push through the pain barrier, that this is where races are always won or lost by great athletes. Another friend of mine shared a very amusing story about meeting my father in the gym. Whenever you see my father in the gym, people are friends with him, know that he was a very active man. Despite this friend of mine always running in the opposite direction, because he knew that as soon as he would bump into Gavin, Gavin would grab him by the scruff of his neck and put him into a training session, or a 90-minute torture session, which he called it, gave us so much enjoyment in seeing people push themselves beyond their boundaries, develop their mental aptitude, and serve others. He loved watching people grow and develop into their full potential. Dad took personal development so seriously that he started the Watson Corporate University on the Bosasa campus in Johannesburg. Here, employees of the company could further their education by taking courses that were accredited by major universities. The employees would have access to professors on site that could assist in mentoring them through their courses and all their coursework. The corporate university was a huge success and received international awards from the Global Council of Corporate Universities. Dad's happiness. Dad was most happy when he was with his family, particularly the grandchildren. It was always so beautiful to see him lose himself when he was sitting on the couch playing silly games with any one of the grandchildren. It was almost as if time stood still for a moment. Dad really loved this verse in the Book of Luke. I believe it was what he was thinking when he lost when he was wasting time with his grandchildren. People were also bringing babies to Jesus for him to place his hands on them. When the disciples saw this, they rebuked them. But Jesus called the children to him and said, "Let the little children come to me, do not hinder them. For the kingdom of God belongs to them, such as these. Truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." My mother. The strength of a man and his family rests in the tender hands of his wife. Today I would also like to thank you, Mom, for allowing Dad to bless the lives of so many. Dad sacrificed 25 years of his life holding an incredible organization. An incredible organization which provided employment to almost 5,000 people. Bosasa pioneered every market sector that they worked in, touched the lives of everyone they worked with. Thank you, Mom, for supporting them and being a safe place. Spending time with family home and key always re-energized him and kept him focused on what is really important in his life. His family. Lastly, to my father's Bosasa family, thank you for loving him, honoring him, and bringing so much joy to his world. The firefighters, the prayer warriors, the A-team, Dad wrote a beautiful story with all of you in it, and he loved you dearly for being a part of it. It has been 40 years since my father first died, I'm not quite sure if everyone knows this, but 40 years ago there was an attempted assassination of his wife. He was stabbed in the chest and he lost 16 pints of blood which bled out to an operating table. That was 1979. I believe he was given a second chance and he was reborn to fulfill God's plan for his life, which he did so gracefully. As the Israelites took 40 years to make it to the promised land, so it took Dad 40 years to make it back home to God, his Father. God works in seasons, and as the season with Dad has now ended, and a new dawn rises for all of us, it would not be fitting that I not close the season with the writing from Andrew Murray, which I believe is my father. Humility is perfect quietness of heart. It is to expect nothing, to wonder at nothing that he's done to me, to feel nothing that he's done against me. It is to be at rest when nobody praises me or when I am blamed or despised. It is to have a blessed home in the Lord where I can go and shut the door and kneel to my Father in secret. And I have peace in the deep sea of calmness where all around and above is in trouble. Rest in peace, Dad.
Thank you. Joe is the chairman of the what is now called African Global. And Joe is probably one of the first people that joined Gavin when he moved to start his operations in Gauteng. He comes here representing the men and women, some of them in his congregation today. You see the way, the same blue that Gavin created. This is the same blue that Gavin wore, the same blue that you would find that the staff at the airport wore, the same blue that you would find staff at the connector services wore, the same blue that you would find at some of our youth facilities. This was the CEO who could wear a new suit in London, and yet he chose to wear the same blue that the security guard would wear. Gentlemen.
Thank you, MC. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. As the MC was introducing me, I'm Joe Kumele, part of the leadership, African Global, and I have been tasked just to say a few words on behalf of the African Global family. To the world's family, as you know, we are one family. That is African Global, and the world's in down the side. We always refer to ourselves as one family. And for us to come here to really send Gavin to live in our specific place, we just want to send our condolences to each and every one of you. And also, the most important thing is that, you know, the sacrifice of the family, as Rob has said, for 25 years, their dad was up and down. And during those times, first time we were starting up, we didn't have time really to, you know, to come down here. It was coming down every second month for the simple reason that we were running around trying to build up an organization that Ron referred to at one stage, employing over 5,000-6,000 staff members. And you know that as a result of that, there's so many dependents. Part of the whole family. I first got to know Gavin in 1995. He came down with his team to the mine I was working at, and at the event in Umalanga. They had to come and do a presentation to management in Guinea. It was that time, and then Diambo, they were busy in the mine hostels doing catering, and our mine was not outsourced. At that time I was working as an IR officer, and by default I was invited to a meeting to interpret for the meeting. It was also part of the presentation. So when his team came from Diallo, Kevin was doing the presentation. And I expected him, you know, do it in English and I interpret. And to my surprise, he did the whole presentation in English. And I think that's where I realized this is a different character. I mean, it was way back in 1995. And I mean, in the mind of us who have been exposed in the environment, is that, you know, the closest one can get to a black language is far out. I mean, here was a guy who hit the whole presentation. And management were very alarmed because they thought that it was just taking a ticket. And from there on, I remember the consequences. I'll just tell you a short story. Consequences of that, after a meeting, the union said, look, we want to these guys to change life of our people, cater for them, and management didn't want to march. And as a result of that, a week after that, the staff they had to sit down and management tried, coerced the branch, go speak to the people. The guy said, no, they're not coming out until you agree that here's the care of our source to these guys. And management didn't understand why these guys in particular. And they said, look, go and see their operation. Management, the union, and some of the staff went up to where it was given to the deep. We went to see where Diallo was operating. And this way I realized that, you know, what he was saying was not just a PR exercise. He was really changing the mind. Because his motto was that only decent thing a miner can get is a decent meal. With breakfast, with lunch, and supper. And that was gathered. And after that, management still didn't want to, then the employees had to sit down. They had to call him all the way from Jordan to go underground, his way to come out. It was gathered. And I think from there on, I realized that it was 95, 96, he invited me to come and join the team, and the rest is history. That's been together since then. But I think for me, most importantly, and all the staff of African Development Bosasa knows that, you know, Gavin was the type of person that believed in team. That's the first thing. He believed in training and development. For him, it wasn't just a story or a PR or one of those things where people get points just because they've been training them. He lived it. He believed in true empowerment. Every time there was an opportunity, you not just took one or two people, you took a team to go out and go and be developed. I think one of his passions was technology. He was always fascinated with technology. That's why I think most of the time when we started, we focused on the mines. After 10 years, we changed our direction, we picked new opportunities. Even then, we had to go out, different places, different destinations, we work, look for technology, bring it into the country, we empower you into that and all that. That's why most of the time our company was in cutting edge. And for me, also, besides all that, the most touching thing is that, because, you know, 8 years, you didn't realize that we didn't have enough time running around, even going to check. In those years, we're doing presentation left, right, and center. And that's when we started going to parameters. Look, in all our quest to build the material side, we also need to make sure that our spiritual side is catered. That's why I started that. And that was open to everyone. Not just us as leadership, each and every one of our staff members were welcome for the cleaner and better. That was the man that did not allow the rules to confine into the box. Never. Gavin always, if you look at his unconventional way of doing things, when he first came to the organization, he didn't want tackles. He said, you know what, tackles confine people to certain things. He didn't want it. He didn't want offices. He said, look, I believe in open land because people hide behind offices. That's why he never even had an office. Only had his cell phone and he moved around. It was him. And people were surprised. How come the CEO would have the biggest office in the block and all that? But he decided, you know, for me to know what is going on in the organization, I'll be able to sit wherever. And that was there. And I think all of us are living by his person, we are really saved. Because every day, I think there's a lot of things that he taught us. I think for me and for the rest of the team, they know that one of those things that Gavin never allowed himself to be attached to the things of the soul. That's why for him, material things didn't matter. Even the car that he was driving, most of the time, all what he wanted was a cheaper. Whether it's driving a Ford Buffalo or whatever, most of the time, I mean, I have a passion for cars. So most of the time, we used to go all the vehicles for him. The only time you see it when he's got him. And you'll be annoyed because he said, why all this? I just need four wheels to move around. Just a safe car, that's it. So it's not like he was not attached to the brand, he was not attached to anything, and so on. And I think the other thing, proclamation was the issue of a uniform. From day one, he said, guys, for us to be one team, you can't have Kaiser Chiefs out in the field wearing different set of equipment. Even when you need to look at yourself. Whether you're a senior guy, whether you're a junior guy. And get the staff members and you can see the team around you. Everybody is looking the same. And I think it was the man who built an identity for each and every one of us. I think with this passing, in closing, I would say that we, on our side, he was the leader, as we call him, he was always the leader. He used to tell us, he said, look, I will not ask you to do what I can't do. It was his motto. So many days he said, do a presentation, then ask him. If he had to drive around, check on unit or wherever, he would do that himself. So he was the type of a person who was not lazy, hard working. I mean, the sacrifice that he made for himself to be up there for 25 years without his family. I mean, I don't want to know the family in 15 years after that. But that was there. He didn't allow his family just to be here because he said, I don't want to put my family on the rest of me. I want that you are my family, and you need to be the country. And that was the man. I mean, I can tell you hours and hours. That was the man. He just made us to feel and to look for the opportunities. I mean, being able to do this, again, was the fact that you know, he was always smiling. For him, I mean, I came from an environment, I mean, where the mind was there. You know, it was not mine. You know, just do your job, and that's it. But when I came into this environment, Gavin came into this environment. Even when he was angry, the next day is forgotten. I mean, some of you guys know how many times we came and say, fire the guy, the next day is forgotten. The guy is back here, he'll be one for you, reemploy the guy. So, but Gavin said, you know, fire, you can't do that, because then breaking the rules, say, I don't care. Bring back the guy back. It was Gavin. Always forgive, always forgetting, you know, the past. You are always, I think that's why I think most people don't even know what to expect. It means the future. Because you are always looking at the future. You never look at it. I think for me, that's the most important thing. Even with all these episodes and all of that, I think in closing, I would just say, you know, it pains me personally. You know, even for his belief in God. People verify himself, they make it part of a joke. I mean, the fact that he led a lot of people to God, people just take it as a joke. He made it his passion. He used to invite people. He didn't care whether how many people were there. He always said, two or three are three, so shall we be. He didn't care. He never forced anybody to come in and into those prayer meetings. Yet, if you look at the people, will verify him for that, make it as if you know what is encouraged for somebody to pray. We all know it's not. A lot of people pray every day. And we just wanted to be sure that all of us make sure that we're okay. In closing, I just want to read a message to the family so that they know that during this difficult time, they are not alone. This is, life is a kind of like a party. You invite a lot of people. Some live in, some stay all night. Some laugh with you, some laugh at you. And some show up really late. But in the end, after the fun, there are a few who stay to help you clean up the mess. And most of the time, they aren't even the ones who made the mess. These people are your true friends. And in life, they're the only ones who matter. And to the family, there's a message I just want to know. Those are the people that are in this hall who are the true friends of the Lord's family. Thank you.
Oh,
how we carry out, and this is how we celebrate. Thank you very much. And we move on swiftly. The Watson family, as everyone would know, very close knit for the many generations. I mean, if you see from where they are and the young people and the little ones that have been there, have been very, very close knit. One of the brothers, Charles, is coming to speak on behalf of the family. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome back.
And unfortunately, people that know the watching this, even the way the program works. Joe Gamal is ahead of me. But I'm Gavin's younger brother, shouldn't I be the head of Joe? But you see, the Bosasa family was very close to Gavin's heart. So you fit it in where he would have wanted you to fit in. The Bosasa board and the Bosasa people were close to Gavin's heart. And when Tandy, all four from 8th of Tandy, weighing 40k, said to me in Johannesburg, she said, Gavin's that understand. We knew already better than you did. Because he spent a lot more time with us over the last 20 years. So in many ways, the programs were dictated to by people that know me better than I have over the last 20 years. So when I had a call from Ses Senior and they wanted to have the program go a certain way, I said, well, these are who's the looking and moving at it. What did I do? I told my body, man. I said, clearly, no. See, I'm telling you, I'm getting this. Who are you? Was up the Lully and CT, the anti, now we don't close. We, fortunately, Senior was out of town when we got up there discussing what would happen and where Gavin would be buried and where the memorial service would be. But there was a strong push because most of his family, as in the Bosasa family, and outweigh us by 4,500 to maybe 20, wanted it in Johannesburg. Because that family was down. And Forty Sassini was out of town because 3-4 weeks ago Sassini had buried his brother. And the Siopela family decided that Gavin was now petty and he's going to be buried in Limpopo. But Leanne said, and we're a family that respect everybody. Our women, our leaders, the church, and if Leanne says you want to come here, so will be. So we've come this today to bury Gavin and to say goodbye to him and to say, oh my gosh, cool. That's what we have today. But I don't want to take your time because I can say so many things about Gavin. But I'll be wasting time that is more important for other people to speak and to tell me about him other than what his family says about him. But what I'd like to say is that when you read the scripture and say God's thoughts aren't our thoughts, God's ways aren't our ways, God's timing for Gavin was what it was. Wasn't where we would hope it to be, or when we think it should be, or when we think we should have lived to 92 or more than our mother did, or at 81 from our father did. God took Gavin at the time that God had brought him. God's timing is perfect. And I wanted to say more, but Roth tends to take things that I wanted to say. This shows the thought pattern of the Boston family. We don't have to communicate things, we just know that. And I wanted to quote something in Johannesburg that Roth took and quoted before I could. And today I wanted to quote from the Reverend Andrew Murray, who was a Scottish theologian that had huge influence on the Inge Kerk in this country, but not being into it. Because we are men of faith, women of faith, a family of faith. And I want to say what Gavin would want me to say, because I've seen the media of late, since the memorial in Johannesburg. I want to say, we believe the Lord God is above all, and we are supposed to love him above all, and that we're supposed to love our neighbor as ourselves, and that's what Gavin wanted, and that's what he put upon us, and my father put upon us, and my mother did, so that's the way it is. But also to be understood correctly, the Watsons believe in freedom of worship. Whatever your religion is, we as the Watson family believe you have a right and a space and to respect what your religion is, and we love it if you respect our religion. Because our Christianity is not just a religion, it's a way of life. We believe in living it. There's my father would always say to us, be careful. careful, church, because there are many Christians, but people don't see them as followers of Christ. We intend to follow Christ. But that's not to say we believe that we are holy for God. Because we can say as the Apostle Paul, we are sinners saved by grace. We can say as the Apostle Paul, we are the chief of all sinners. And I want to conclude my remarks by saying that at this juncture, it's like there's so many people here that want to talk about that and they speak about him as I don't know what I would do. But I want to say this is how we do it. Ask him. There's a hotel up there, Sibuya, and see Mongo. Sibuya, and see Mongo. City Bike.
Cheesy candy, you know.
I want to say, and it can be said in no better way, I'm a gosh, I'm a gosh.
Thank you very much, spoken like a good brother, but at the same time, challenged all of us to make sure that we're able to move forward properly. In every family, interestingly, in every family, you always find that there is that one that ends up becoming a brother, becomes the sixth, and the seventh, and the eighth. And I've soon found out in my time that I've known the family that there's brother number six, sister number nine, and they all have to convene and then agree. For the purpose of today, moving forward, who is brother number five? And I think the decision was unanimous. I know some of them don't like it, but in a democratic place that they agreed that you could achieve number five. Officially, number five, not could achieve over time. Officially number five, brother.
This is my family.
Gavin is our big brother. I met this woman when I was in my early 20s, but now I'm in my late 60s. We've been together more than 40 years. These are the sons of the old man called Mtoko. Mtoko Chole. Because their father had a big head and big ears. A Christian. Gavin is the one who introduced me to the family. I would like to say this. For me to be part of this family was a blessing, which is God. I am what I am today because of this family. If you touch me, you touch me. Because these are my brothers. It's Gavin Joseph Watson, Ronald James Watson, Vernon Michael, Thompson Watson, and Daniel John Watson. He's the youngest of the brothers, and the elder sister, Sharon, was married to Mr. Tarpon. When I met them, these kids, they were not there. These guys were bachelors. They never had work. I had to close house up for them to be wise. They were staying at 34 Pump Drive. Gavin is our big brother. He slept in the outside room. Chicky, the room in top, and Gavin, and Ronnie, other rooms inside the house. I never saw their girlfriends. Because they were very secretive. But at that stage, at that time, I had many, many girlfriends. You know, they used to call me in order. For this is a Christian family. If you know them from their father, and their mother was called Ubobi. People from Mother's Day used to call it Umanwa. Those were the parents. Valence one day he says to me, our company is going to set the house here at Cape Road. I said, what are you going to do then, Valence? He said, no, man. There's a lady there who wants to speak to you. We went together, our company went together to this house. But I saw this lady, man, she's very young. And then she spoke to him and he went outside. When she left, I said, Mama, no, no. This woman is too, she's too young. You're a chicken man. He said, no, man, she's old enough, you know, to be my girlfriend. That was my lead. Then at the end, he got married to Aileen, and Gavin, you know, organized one of the biggest weddings in this town, at 34 Park Drive. The whole township was there to celebrate with us. These are the men that put me to joining the African National Guard. And they changed me to the non-Christians. to join the African National Congress, and were members of him who go on to underground structures of the movement. We never operated with underground structures of the movement. The contribution Gavin has made a lot of contribution in our struggle. He helped the guys at Stefan, sending them clothes. Amamu trained the township. He gave them food and clothes. And so we never saw from Amamu trained Soweto on the sea, not Soweto in Germany, Soweto on the sea. He gave them a soccer kit and went together to deliver that kit. You know, I find it so strange when this Bosasa CEO came on. They were portraying our brother as a criminal and as a thief. Gavin has been a good heart. He's been helping our organization for the donkey years. There was nothing wrong for him to assist or to help the African National Congress because it's our organization, it's our party.
Some people call me by name,
They said I'm the Kentucky. Some said I'm Mr. Houston. Some said my ears are like black watches. Because they were after the Watsons. I was in hospital for, I would say, 6 weeks. Ronnie, a soldier, that was in the sofa, in balance and shit. I was scared. Because I was in a terrible state. But Ronnie was there almost every day. Looking after me. After being discharged from the hospital, he took me straight to prison. I didn't heal properly. And I was tortured. You know that day when the house was burned? He took us to the provincial hospital. I said to Jeff, we were interrogated. And it was very cold that evening. Imagine people with 30 degrees, 45%, getting interrogated by the security forces. He dreamed that we burned the house because the Nazis wanted to claim insurance. All that junk was a false story. Then I was sent to prison. They were also. I was sent to Swartkos police station. I stayed there for some months. Then I was referred to what I felt. That's what I felt. And they went at away. The only man who was outside was there, looking after the family, trying to assist my family, and asked why we were still in the jail. You know when you vote, the lady vote, and gloves, very notorious security police in this area. He came to me several times, trying to beg me to be an informant of our money to serve the girls. Like many of you may be sitting here, you know, you say, yeah, my brothers. There's a lot I can say about this family. I'm a fifth brother. Achimukaya is a fifth brother. Gamanda.
Fully and adequately represent all of us who will be able to
and brought to the podium today. The Watson brothers were involved in sports, some of them very bad, some of them tried, some of them very good, some of their kids better than their dads. And coming from that sports fraternity, to say well to on behalf of the sporting community, ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome OR Tambo.
Blacks are playing rugby in South Africa. But Watson Brothers, we had a plan that some of our letters must be sealed abroad. That's how we were not recognized. And that made us a threat to the system of South Africa, a special branch. So they were pushing us. Now, the Watson Brothers, especially Chiki, Valance, and their father, they played a big role of Kwaro, and even those guys that were playing for Kwaro, some of them didn't work, but they had jobs. We had dealers in the township that were recruited by Gavin to come and work in their farms. So, with those few words, the Watson Brothers played a big role in our spider and also to improve our situation in their place. Thank you.
Freedom! Freedom! Belong and turn!
people that were remaining behind was a team called the Amabut. The army was the ANC in the location. That's the language we need.
Unanimous decision to be represented by Ukusta. That was at the time when they took that decision. Gavin really came into the struggle. He didn't come through a favor. He came as an individual that got his own ideas.
Thank you.
the Kuga development, it was his brain. I don't know why Charlie never has a word on the show, because this was a secret show the Nationalist Party that they had for many years. I don't know where he got it. And Mike Tata, my tool, and he put on the table the Kuga IDZ. Kevin Wakeford, Corner, was the first one to remember. There are opportunists who were given a lot of opportunities and time to do things, but they failed. But Gavin has things to show. Tangible, not theories. Jobs were created. My friends were based in Falkland tells me that Gavin orchestrated the establishment and the finding of 33 creatures in the poverty ravaged Orange Farm area. Children homes and facilities, care facilities across the province, everywhere. Those are labor intensive things. This is the Kleshawar. It's not talking and fourth industrial revolution. That is true power. They say this project touched more than 1,000 young people through running youth centers, giving them material, spiritual, and physical support, physical fitness, about one. Because if the children are not playing sport, that is why, if you notice, I said that when these guys revive the game, you see, in England, every time there's a good boxer, every time who was listening to cricketer the other day, the English commentators, the first thing they're going to say, they're going to say, ah, I'm going to see more kids playing in the streets, they're going to see more boys running in the night. That's a result of that, because the people back there,
the
The Watsons never turn their backs on the struggle and their mission. They continue to support as a result. Many of the convicts were left outside jail, were still being taken all over the country and hidden by the very Watsons when their business was being promoted. And if I were to talk of intelligence in our days, I would have said, yes, Africa would be responsible. I hear you now in the radio TV saying that you stayed at the Watsons' house every Scottish when he was hiding from the police. Well, the public is responsible there, yeah? Because he could have brought the whole enemy and army there. But anyway, that's how they did it, through sheer bravery. Because nobody would have done that.
From that time onwards, that thing, Yakubeka Kuya Yongisa.
all those things, which led to that, they went to Dakar and all of that. It came from where? From the little things that happened here. Because the reason for the boycott was to make sure that the white people in town understand what was going on in the township. But I have to say this, as I'm going to sit down. Well, you've got the people here. And when you have people around you, the most important thing, you check with who are these people. It is nice to have a lot of people, but at the end of the day, for you, is to understand who are these people. And these people are people whose lives have been touched by Gavin. By Gavin's work, by his influences, by his being here. And I am saying to the family that keep going. Don't stop doing good. I know there are times in life when you say, for what all of this? No. No. Who knows? If I was never put into your home and given a knife and fork, as a joke as it was at the time, when I couldn't handle these things. But today, here I am, where I am, respecting human beings, understanding that there are good and bad people in the world. And I'm saying to the family, keep it up, don't give up. You've got the muscles to handle it. Thank you.
Thank you. Long live the spirit of Comrade Gavin. Long live. Long live the spirit of Comrade Gavin. Long live.
It is inevitable that in working
some individuals and some families must take the lead and suffer, that the road to freedom is via the cross, close quote. The Watson family suffered a lot under the apartheid and were constantly harassed by the regime for their belief that South Africa belongs to all who live in it, black and white, and that no race should be dominant over the other. When we count families that were at the forefront of our struggle and who suffered immensely, we must not omit the Watson family. It would be disingenuous to do so. In the ANC, we are taught never to forsake each other as comrades, particularly when one of us is facing difficult challenges. Seemingly, the post-apartheid era has consumed us so much that we forget this important principle that should bind us. We tend to dance and rejoice at the problems of other comrades. In doing that, we play directly at the hands of our political opponents. I can't find any reason other than the fact that Gavin and his family have remained true and loyal servants of the African National Congress. The village is also the Lord of the Lord of the Lord. Let the way now be done. He's actually
Gamma,
Utotombe, not that I would deny that. It wasn't the competition and selflessness that they have done. We are indeed hugely indebted to this family, the family that has donated all their sons. You've heard the Ukombe Valencia speaking, the Ronis and Chikis, to contribute in the struggle for the liberation of our people. There's only one fault I found on Comrade Gavin's life, and many of us have the same fault in our journey of life. Comrade Gavin has been out the wolves in sheep's clothing to get closer in his life. And we have seen how wolves who came into Comrade Gavin's life pretending to be harmless revealed in their true colors. It is a sad lesson for all of us to learn that in our quest to be a united and a non-Russia nation, we must know who is truly on our side. Most of the time, our true allies are those who never sold out during the difficult times, and not overnight Democrats who use the convenience of our democratic victory to act as if they share the same beliefs and values with us. How I wish Comrade Gavin would have left us having cleared and put things into correct perspective in the time zone of commission. But those who are actually still alive and who, those who know more with the work that we have done, indeed, they must know what is like and put things into perspective in that commission. Let me leave you, fellow mourners and family, with a few words that are found in the Timothy 4, verse 6, which read, and I quote, "For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, and I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also to love his appearing." Close quote. Rest in peace, Comrade Gavin. May your activist revolutionary soul rest in peace. Nivile Mandasebai, if I can't be, Comrade Gavin is living in Fort Elizabeth at a time when our gangs are in control of our society, at a time when gangsters are doing as they wish, at a time when this very important part of our province and the country is rapidly degenerating. We're calling everyone to come on board, turn around the situation. This is the economic hub of the entire province. We can't grow the economy of this province if this area is not functioning properly. Thank you very much.
And we talk in the history, Funa Indoba, Tanin Kula, Nias.
like also to recognize Dimpo Ani, the wife of our late Chris Ani, who is with us here. And indeed, business leaders and all important persons and honorees who are with us here today. We are here to bid a farewell to Comrade Gavin and to convey our condolences to the wife and the entire Watson family. To this extraordinary man who comes from an extraordinary family. Coming from this province, which at times is referred to as one of the mothers of the African National Congress. But this particular city, which is known as the home of the African National Congress. Comrades, we have heard almost everything about Comrade Gavin. What type of a person he has been, what type of a family he comes from, what contribution they have made in the struggle to liberate South Africa, and what contribution has been disrupted insofar as Comrade Gavin is concerned, as he made a contribution to develop this country. I had an opportunity to be invited by him to where his operations are. He wanted me to come and see what he was doing. I was still the president of the country then, very interested to see what are we doing in terms of changing South Africa to be what we wanted to be. I was amazed by the operation, so advanced, with almost every answer to the challenges we had. And I was very happy to see, after a while, a comrade making such visible contribution in our country, and a brother, and a friend. He's the only one I remember who has come to my village, to my little home called Ganja. Just to see how this Ganja that was taught about. He wanted to see it for himself, and he went a good time. Director of the program, I was introduced to the Watson family, indeed the brothers, by one of my leaders, Comrade Pilison Zwai. That is to meet them, to see them, having heard their name before. Zwai, who among other things headed the intelligence of the African National Congress. He was bowing out of that position I had been identified to occupy that position. He had to introduce me, therefore, to a number of sectors, units, everything that had to do with intelligence. And indeed, when introduced, he said, I have a unit of comrades in the Eastern Cape who are operating very effectively. There were other comrades who worked under Mzwai, who then had to operate under me in exile, who I think were servicing these comrades more directly. And firstly, when we met these comrades, surprised by the beliefs, the thoughts, they were covered. More, but killed by a communist. Only to find they intermingled English and Tosa as they were explaining very complicated things. And I'd worked with them for a long time, and these comrades were one of the most advanced units in terms of reporting on intelligence. And of course, as I worked with them, I came to know these were not just recruited at the time. They've been members of the African National Congress for a long time, and they were operating underground. They were in fact recruited to this specialized work of the ANC by comrades who knew them. And indeed, it did not take long for me to appreciate the quality of work that they were giving. Very incisive in terms of the information. One of the advantages was that they could move without any thinking about the color line, across the color line. But also, as business people, they were able to get the kind of information that, because of the color, other units and other comrades could not get. And therefore, they were very important in the life of the African National Congress Intelligence Department. Did not take long to see how committed these comrades were to the struggle to liberate South Africa, but also to the policies of the African National Congress. But they were also a unique unit because they could put their additional point of view in a manner that would not ignore. They said more than any other time, Comrade Ronald, because he was very agile in movement and very good in giving reports, written and unwritten, very well. They became the big asset of the African National Congress. what you said as an attempt to their lives. We saw it in action when Comrade Ron was in Botswana in a hotel. An enemy operator came to kill him. Ronnie Bindron, he stood up and dealt with that enemy, removed the gun from his hand, and overpowered him, and therefore succeeded to leave. In other words, the enemy hated this family to a point that they wanted them to be killed. And I believed when we got our freedom in 1994, I thought that we'd passed that chapter. We'd passed that chapter. It was now time to rebuild South Africa. And I'm saying this because I've become very worried in the manner in which many comrades are dying these days. Particularly knowing as I do how some intelligence organizations operate. And I'm hoping that the investigation will indeed prove us wrong who are worried. The report that the family gave me has a lot of gaps in the manner in which Comrade Gavin was found and how he died. And since the investigation is still ongoing, I hope there will be a report that will satisfy all of us. There are comrades who have died very suddenly. Who are seen to be some obstacle in one form or the other. Perhaps some time will come for some truth to come out. They are comrades I would not want to count, who have left us very mysterious. And I hope Comrade Gavin is not counted among those that were cleverly removed from the sea. And I know that Comrade Gavin has died at a point when his name has been raised, and indeed, as I've been informed, he has been preparing to go to the commission to respond to a number of allegations that have been made against him, so that he could clear some of the matters that needed to be cleared. And I hope perhaps those in the company will also have the opportunity. We are living in an era that is very strange, that those who fought for our freedom and therefore were vilified by the apartheid system and those who were not vilified they've been turned the other way around. Those who are fighting and sacrifice everything to bring about freedom are today made the worst people to look in the country. And our media plays a big role in this.
Sure.
It's a narrative that has been deliberately shaped to undermine our freedom. Now, I just want to say one or two things. I don't want to say too many things because some of the comrades who have been taken away are comrades who are very close to me in terms of the work and understanding of where we come from and where we go. There is something I think we did not watch. That South Africa is a very strategic country, geographically. For the history that has seen men driving machines across the seas and oceans, it has become very important. At the level of global economy and global politics, South Africa is very important. And therefore, there are people who have felt South Africa could not be allowed not to be under their control. And that means they spend time identifying those whom they believe are an obstacle. And they are hated. And they are always looked at to be people who need to be removed. And I hope we are not dealing with that case here. Particularly because the Watson family have been under the spotlight of our enemies for many years, and it had not stopped. Hence, sadly, we got to the stage where a commission was used to further deal with this family. And I'm saying, I'm hoping very sincerely that there will be explanations of many of the things. And I think Comrade Premier has made an important point, which I don't want to repeat. But I think it is important to understand, particularly to those who are comrades, that our effort to liberate our country is not yet over. You should know that what led us into negotiations more directly and very specific was because of the global changing of the balance of forces. When the socialist world disappeared, the world had changed in a particular way. Apartheid South Africa could no longer use the excuse that if we allowed the ANC to take over the country, we would be allowing the communists. That was an argument they used to persuade Western countries not to dump them, to support them. But the time came when we had to negotiate. Now when we're negotiating, I think, there are some of the things of finer but very important thing we did not watch at the time. Perhaps we took things for granted. For an example, when we're negotiating, or to put it more correctly, before we negotiated, the apartheid system had a problem to deal with. What has this asked itself a question? And we did not know this. What are we going to do with the enemy agents that are within the liberation movement? And that issue was avoided in the debate, I mean in the negotiations, probably because it's a sensitive issue. And if I don't say it, who will say it? We believed that when we negotiated and concluded everything, everything was over. And therefore, even the issue of pursuing the enemy agents was no longer the issue. Because what else would they be informing on if the war had ended of liberation? Very simplified logic, we did not know. We negotiated in good faith, but what did the apartheid authorities do? They did not want to hand over or to leave alone their agents. They worked with their friends, other countries, big countries, and one country in particular, they had an agreement to hand over those agents to an enemy. This was their country, because we're now going to all come together. And they handed over their agents with their files to particularly, the majority of them, to a particular country, so that they will continue to erode our freedom, to undermine the government, to dwell with them, so that they will claim the ANC's failing to run the country. And in the process, as we negotiate, the ANC had to dismantle its intelligence structures, an organization, as we call it in Bogota. Those who were going to the army, those who were going to the police, had to abandon the membership of the ANC. And yet, our enemy was consolidating that force to the hands of a country outside that continued to work. And we came to know later that therefore an element that we thought had come to an end was in fact transferred, is in fact operating. That country has two files. A file from apartheid time to these agents, and a new file for that country. Why this? Because South Africa is very important. Important at times that we don't understand. And therefore, people who have been active, who are known, it has made the situation not to be safe for them. And I wish and hope that Comrade Gavin has not been a victim of that approach. I hope. And I hope investigations will clarify this matter. There are reasons why I say this, and I don't want to go any further. But South Africa is a strategically important country, geographically, politically, economically, globally. This family has suffered because of its political clarity and commitment to the freedom and democratic government of this country and their contribution, particularly Comrade Gavin, who was the leader of this. And I wish we can learn from here that we need to address things differently. If we don't, we're all going to die one by one. Those who are known to be problematic in different ways. Heart attack, I now know it can be induced. I have been poisoned myself. I'm not talking something that I don't know. And I thought at this point, because Comrade Gavin has been an important element in the setup of the South African country where they've been raising these managed to to understand South Africa as a real rainbow nation and work for it. And it is important to make this point. If loyal guards, you might be in trouble. If you were sitting in another country, you hear that there is a person called in South Africa, Jacob Zuma, you will believe he's the biggest criminal. He has been labeled the most corrupt person, but nobody has even given a teaspoon that he stole anyway. It's a narrative that has been created deliberately to say those who may know things need to be rubbished so that they look like criminals, corrupt, etc. When I was appearing and I have not yet finished in the commission, I told a story of a plan that was hatched for me in 1990 that has been deepening in terms of implementation. In fact, in the Ika person, for me, it is absolutely important that it's not yet over. But I thought it is important to make you aware. I would like to say thank you to the Watsons family. I've worked with them, they are like my brothers. And I'm happy that the children of the brothers are as their fathers. We are part of this family. I'd like to say, as we say goodbye to Comrade Gavin, you must be consoled by the fact that here lies a real man, a soldier of our struggle, a comrade who understood the need to liberate South Africa, but also understood the need to build South Africa to be a better country that takes care of its citizens. A real Democrat, revolutionary, in practice, not just in theory, as we have heard. We like to say, Lalani Ngenxa, Nkosi yobotha, sibonge nani siva lentlungu njengoba naniniva. Umfowethu, umfowethu, abafowethu labo, nabodadewethu naboma. Owen umsebenzi wenzile kodwa besesijonge kwabancinci kuba benze wabo bafunze noma balandele kodwa kababa kuba isene le ndlela esihamba isafuna amadoda namadodana nabomama. It's not good to feel in our own country we're not to help us feel we are safe. I want to say to Comrade Gavin, farewell, comrade. You made your contribution. You left too early for us. I always feel very bad to say goodbye to people who are younger than me instead of them saying to us who are older. goodbye, you've done your work. But this indeed is a comrade who made a contribution to the African organization, the African National Congress, and in the country. And we'll always remember him and remember his family. Farewell, comrade. Wamba kakuhle. Gqoka gqoka. Amandla! Awethu! Umshini wami, umshini wami. Umshini wami, umshini wami. Umshini wami, umshini wami.
Yeah.
at that time that Gavin enjoyed the respect and cherished very much. At this time, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to request Pastor Francis to come to the fore. As Pastor Francis come over, I'm sure most of us will have this program. You'll realize that on the inside there are hymns. We are amazing, Pastor Francis, whilst we see how great is our art. For those of us who do not know the hymn is writing, please feel to join the audience as we play. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Australia. My name is Bosasa, like the program director of this opportunity. I appreciate your time on this occasion. I'd like to also acknowledge Watson's family, our former president, the mayor, all the officials here present, the employees of African Global. Greetings to all of you. Amen. I'm going to share shortly scripture that we're going to think together on this scripture in the book of John, chapter 14, verse 1 through 2. The Bible reads, how frail is humanity, how short is life, how full of trouble. We blossom like a flower and then wither. Like a passing shadow, we quickly disappear. Father, we bless your words on this difficult occasion of Father God. And we thank you that you are the God who has been here before we came. You created us, O Father God. You know us. You know our going out and our coming in. Bless you, Father God, for our brother who has gone to be with you for all. Thank you for these words that will come forth to encourage us, to encourage our hearts and our lives. So, Father, for the glory of your name, we pray that you bless this word and that your spirit will touch our hearts and that your spirit will comfort us and comfort the family, O Lord. For the glory of your name, in Jesus' mighty name I pray. And everyone say, Amen.
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 We all know that the book of Job is a profound book, a profound work on faith. The book is started with a prologue which very much portrays the pictures, so it gives us an overview, an idea of what Job was going to go through without the knowledge of Job himself. And it shows us also that the spiritual dimension, that the divine of God was aware of whatever that Job went through. And it also closes with an epilogue where we see God answering to Job and also teaching us some lessons out of this book. You know, as I say, the main body of this composition is cast as a series of speeches that alternate between Job and men of conventional wisdom. And also we see Job himself questioning and asking questions why he was going through whatever he was going through. We know that Job was a devoted servant of God, but now we see him afflicted with losses, especially the loss of his children. You know, you'll agree with me that you may lose everything, but when it comes to your family, it's very painful. So we see Job here losing his family. So he agonizes over the cause of his plight. And while his friends and counselors confidently provide inadequate reasons, basically they turned against him, they turned against Job, even pointing fingers at him. We as the family of Kokedi, as friends and employees and prayer partners and business partners, all of us have been struggling with this situation of the loss of our beloved brother, our beloved father, our beloved grandfather, uncle and friend. We've been asking why to God. We've been asking how. We've been asking what, how come. Why did this happen? How did this happen? Asking all these questions. And many others have come with the human wisdom, the conventional wisdom, to try and explain the whole situation based on the human perception and the conventional wisdom, like Job's friend. And in the middle of the questions that Job was asking, and in the middle of the things that his friends were saying, so Job caught a glimpse, you know, he got an understanding of what man is like. He got an understanding before even God had answered him. And Job says in verse 1 and 2 of chapter 14, he says that humanity is frail, fragile, that life is short and also full of troubles. He says life blossoms like flower today, and tomorrow it's no more. And that's our lives. We are here today, but tomorrow we are no more. The truth is, death will come for every human being one day. Hallelujah. Now, in the end, God himself responds to Job by paraphrasing his answer. He said to Job that, Job, let me be God and you remain royal. Just trust me. He says, have faith in me no matter what. No matter what it is that you've gone through, what I'm calling upon you is to put your trust in me. You don't need to understand all the things that you've been going through. All I want from you is just allow me to be God. Hallelujah. And keep faith in me. Keep trusting me. And as the composition of the book reveals, the issue is not very much of cause and effect. The core issue of the book lies in the nature of faith. Job experienced all that he experienced just because of his faith. Are you with me? The aims of most sections in this group is teaching us, one, to show that neither the events of life nor their reasons are what they may appear to be. And secondly, it's to create a deepened personal faith in God. And thirdly, it's to demonstrate the imperfections of human wisdom. And the key lesson here is that the control of the world order continues to belong to God. God controls everything. He knows where to set limits. He knows where to say, you can only go this far. Are you with me? So it's to know that the world order continues to belong to God. Though one should be prepared to go through pain, suffering, even believers, but Job's patience, endurance, and steadfastness became an example to any Christians, even to us today. We are encouraged to trust God through thick and thin. Hallelujah. So Job understands that man's life is short. It blossoms like flower, and then it withers. Like a passing shadow, we quickly disappear. We are no more. And also, times of trouble will come during this lifetime. But one thing we need to keep in mind is that in the midst of it all, God is in control. And he wants us to trust him through the process. He wants us not to rely on human wisdom, but to rely on what the scriptures say. Look into the scripture of the spiritual dimension, because death has no victory over us. Jesus overcame death, as the Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 54 to 58. He says, then, when our dying bodies, meaning when our present bodies, have been transformed into bodies that will never die, this scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh death, where is your victory? Oh death, where is your sting? And he goes on to say, but thank be to God, he gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. So in reality, for us believers, as we know, Brother Gavin was a believer, for us believers, Jesus overcame death. Hallelujah. And what gives death its power, meaning sin? Jesus gave us victory over sin and death. And when we die in this body, we will rise into a different body that will live with the Lord eternally. The Apostle Paul continues to say in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16 through 18, he says, "For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a commanding shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. First, the Christians who have died or the dead in Christ will rise from their graves. Then, together with them, we who are still alive and remain on the earth will be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Then we will be with the Lord forever." He says, so encourage each other with these words. So the Apostle Paul exhorts the believers to encourage themselves with these words, that the Lord will come down from heaven, and that the dead in Christ will rise from their graves, and the believer who is still believing will meet the Lord in the air, and then we will live with him forever. Brother Gavin will rise again. Brother Gavin will rise again. We will meet together with the Lord and live together with the Lord forever. There will be no more death, no more tears, no more pain, no more suffering. And that's what we are looking forward to. And in closing, in the middle of our pain, in the middle of this time of sorrow, we need to remember that our days here on earth is short. Like flowers, we will blossom and wither and die and go to be with the Lord. But while we are still alive, we need to make every day count by keeping our faith in God and having faith that God is in control even when it looks like we are on our own. As family, we need to remain united and continue with the legacy of Brother Gavin, legacy that he left. And as employees and leadership of the organization, we need to continue working with the spirit of unity and excellence towards the goal that Brother Gavin set together with you. Continue to impact the people, continue to impact communities, continue to impact cities and nations, because God is with us. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Before I pray, a few words that I'd like to say. Just 1 minute. Mr. Gavin, my father, I just want to say goodbye. You showed me the love of a true father. You called me when I was away, but when I came back, I found that you are no more. You were a shepherd for this flock, as you always said that Bosasa was a church. Now you are gone. Who will be the shepherd over this flock? But it is well, because we know where you have gone. You've gone to a better place. It is well with your spirit, and it is well with us. Go well, my father. On behalf of all the prayer warriors and Elder Batim, we say goodbye. We love you, and we will continue to love you, and pray toward the legacy that you have left. Amen. I'd love for us to stand up and sing this song, this hymn, the booklet. It is well with my soul. It is well with Brother Gavin where he has gone. It is well with us as well. Because we know he has just gone ahead of us, and he has gone to a better place. Amen. We'll just sing one verse because of time. Amen. pray, O Lord, as we're going to lay our brother to rest. May you comfort the family. May you comfort, Father God, all of us that have been close to him, O Lord. And may you strengthen us for the glory of your name. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord, ladies and gentlemen. We've come to almost at the end of our program, and to render a quick vote of thanks is Jared Watson.
Good afternoon. Just very briefly, a few people would like to thank for being here and for assisting. President Zuma, first and foremost, he honors us by being here today, and we honor him. The Premier of the province, the mayor, all the support staff, and the police, everyone who's come on board to help us in this time. Dubuani, wife of the late Chris Mami, close family friend, we send one to join your husband today. Members of the ANC who've attended to support us, the SACP, members of the ANC Women's League, SANCO, all the sports fraternities that have come to pay their respects today, the MKMVO, especially Ben Sophia, people of Ibai, all those who have travelled from far and wide to be here and support, activists from around the country here today and from afar, those who have been providing support for the family over this time and those working here today, members of the media, Comrade Charles Makula, Sue Gillespie from the First Avenue Funeral Home. He didn't want to be mentioned, but I think that Lungisa has been very supportive of this period and we want to honor him. Arbel Estadazen and the Bocadillo staff, the ANC Ward 7, and Mayor Faku, who attended the home yesterday to hoist the flag for honoring our family. The Bosasa Chairman, Joe Gavin, for his tireless efforts in assisting Gavin and the great Bosasa staff. Papa Leshabane, for everything he's done and put in to get these two events. Sisinya Seopela, we'd just like to offer him condolences over this period. It's not just Gavin he mourned this year, his brother has passed this year, his mother has passed this year. We remain his family. Ronnie, Valence and Cheeky, we see your efforts, 45 years of struggle continues. Archie Mkele, Kevin Wakeford, the greater board of directors from Bosasa, the employees from Bosasa, we thank you for your efforts over the years. We thank you for your continued efforts over this time. We stand with you. Kusta Jack, for kind words this morning, and the family, and all those who have supported us over this period.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've come to the end of our formal proceedings here today. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you very much for your attendance. This is how it's going to work out from here on. Is the choir here? Good. The choir will send procession as it came in. The choir, the board of directors, the family, the pallbearers, and then the leadership of the African National Congress, and then we can all follow from there. The family has agreed that everyone who would like to attend the burial site is free to do so, including members of the people. If you so wish to be at the burial site, you are more than welcome to attend. At the end of the proceedings at the burial site, we all come back here where refreshments will be served. Thank you very much. To stay this program. And we can, again, as we. The other side is forested. Thank you very much. We request everyone to stand as we usher him to his final resting place. Thank you.